on Facebook Live. So welcome, everyone. This is our latest installment for Ask an Expert, or hashtag Ask an Expert series with Kintec. I am Michael Ryan. I'm the Director of Research and Development for Kintec and one of their podorthists. And today's topic is plantar fasciitis, something that is near and dear to a lot of the patients that come into our stores and clinics, and I think is really, really common condition. Today, to speak more on the topic, who's one of our experts on plantar fasciitis is Peter Morcom. Thank you for coming in, Peter.
My pleasure.
Peter is a Canadian board-certified podorthist through the College of Podorthics of Canada. He's been with Kintec for 10 years, coming on 10-year anniversary now. So you reckon how many people have you seen with plantar fasciitis?
Guessing in the hundreds, for sure.
So quite a bit of experience, clinical experience with this condition. So the format for today is going to, we'll cover some frequently asked questions. So what people often want to know when they come in and see us in the clinic, what they will ask us to know about plantar fasciitis. And as with our last Facebook Live features, we'll cover email questions and then, of course, if there are any live questions, let's really take advantage of the fact you're live. And we've got Peter here in the studio to take advantage of his expertise. Feel free to just shoot us a message then on our on the Facebook feed. So let's get straight to it, Peter, if you're
sure.
Ready for it. What is plantar fasciitis?
So we get asked that all the time in the clinic. And you'll hear lots of different answers, so I'm going to try to just make it as plain as I can for you. So your plantar fascia tissue inserts at the back of your heel here and runs out to the beginning of your toes. This connective tissue is used really in propulsion of the foot. It helps turn the foot into a lever and allow you to toe off and move forward as you're walking. And plantar fasciitis is really just the irritation of that tissue. Lots of different reasons. The pain a lot of times is going to be based back in the heel, but the overall term plantar fasciitis just really responds to irritation of your plantar fascia tissue.
Is it common?
Very common. As a podorthist, I see lots of feet problems, but this one is by far, you know, what we're going to see the most. You know, there's lots of other types of injuries that can result in similar feelings of pain. So it's not always plantar fasciitis, but a lot of times that's what we're going to see in clinic.
Why would someone have plantar fasciitis?
That's a pretty common question as well. A lot of times with
plantar
fasciitis, one of the most frustrating things is that it all of a sudden just kind of starts. You know, you wake up one morning maybe and you feel a dull, achy sort of pain down towards your heel, but you don't ever feel an actual incident. There's no real acute injury. So it's really hard to figure out, like, why? What did I do? What did I do wrong? And a lot of times you didn't do anything wrong. You know, it's usually some sort of increased load or increased stress to that tissue. And why that can happen is lots of different reasons, whether it's activity-based, work-based, foot mechanics-based, you know, tightness in tissues. There's lots of different reasons why you can have it. And that's really why it's important to go get yourself assessed, let someone take a look at your gait, your mechanics, to really see, you know, where is your issue arising from.
Now, you mentioned that there's a couple things that could be, someone could have if they have pain on the bottom of their foot. And I guess this is useful for someone to know, because if it's plantar fasciitis, they might get one sort of type of treatment. If it's something else, like let's say they strained a muscle on the bottom of their foot, they may get a different type of treatment. What sort of the different treatments that they might get?
Well, again, you'd really want to look at sort of why you would have it, and then again, the differential diagnosis of what that is. You know, you'll hear a lot of things like heel spurs. You know, a lot of people can have heel spurs, or they're not exactly symptomatic all the time.
Yeah, what is a heel spur? Because, you know, you see that on referrals, and patients will see it because they're so visible on an x-ray, but are they as important as we think they are?
Well, you know, you'll hear different sort of facts on this, but, you know, a lot of people get x-rays and show heel spurs, but they're, like I just said, not necessarily symptomatic, and they can be a result of this constant irritation down into the insertion point of your plantar fascia. But the root cause of your pain is more the irritation, not the heel spur itself. And it's understandable why people think that, because a lot of people will say it feels like there's this stabbing pain down in my heel, there's a nail sticking in my heel. You get an x-ray, it shows a heel spur. What do you mean that's not what I'm feeling? Of course this is what's going on, right? But again, you got to look back at the root cause. What is that irritation coming from? Is it from an excess stretch of that plantar fascia tissue? Is it from excess load or impact forces going into your heel and your plantar fascia? So, that's why you always want to look back. What is the original cause? How we fix that?
And I think the other thing with heel spurs is that they exist even after they get better. So that's a good clue that it's not always the source of pain. So let's say you have plantar fasciitis, you've got this heel pain, and they came in to see you. What would you do for them?
So, the main thing is to try to get into, what are the mechanics. As a Canadian certified podiatrist, we really specialize in lower limb biomechanics. So I'm going to do some functional tests. I'm going to, do a videotaping of a gait analysis on a treadmill, look at some range of motion in your feet, and try to figure out, where is that load coming from? When we look at foot mechanics, there's really two types, if you really wanted to try to classify it, that you're going to see, especially involved with plantar fasciitis. You have your classic overpronations, the term we like to use, which is really just this sort of down and inward rolling motion of the foot. And as that happens, we get some splay through the foot, and it can sort of stretch and increase some stress in your plantar fascia. So,
can you show that on the model? So what? Just so people can visualize
the down and inward rolling motion.
Yeah.
That didn't make enough sense to you there, Michael.
We often use our hands. We've got a nice model here. Right?
Yeah. So the motion of overpronation usually happens through your subtalar joint, which is right here. You can see that, as well as through your mid-tarsal joint. So as the foot weight bears, it wants to roll down and in this way. This isn't the most mobile of foot models.
It's like my foot.
Yeah. It'll be the next foot type we talk about. But as that foot rolls down and in and these bones kind of splay apart, you can again picture this plantar fascia tissue that inserts right here, spreads out to all five of these bones. As that motion happens, we can get some excess stretch or strain onto that plantar fascia tissue. So in that case, in that foot, what we really want to try to do is limit either how much of that motion or how quickly that motion happens, how repetitive that motion is. So one of the good treatment options for that is looking at either off-the-shelf insoles or custom orthotics. I have an example of a custom orthotic here. And really the goal with this foot type is that we would want to get some even contact through the medial arch and a heel cup around the heel to try to reduce the amount of that kind of rolling motion in, reduce some of that strain.
We have a question here. Heidi has posted, so thank you for posting and taking advantage of this live feature. So she writes, I've had it for a couple of weeks now on one of the sides, and she's tried nearly everything, so particularly exercises, ice, some braces that we'll get to here a little bit. What do you do, so we're jumping a little bit ahead here, for recalcitrant cases? What would necessarily be the next step for someone like Haiti to pursue?
So she's gone through sort of the basic conservative treatments, you're saying, stretching, ice. Exercises, ice,
yep.
Rest, I would assume, at some point as well in there. Again, that's where you want to go see your sort of next medical professional, and I would suggest either Canadian certified orthotist or a physiotherapist, someone that knows about foot mechanics, because again, it goes back to why is that strain happening, especially if you've had it before and it kind of goes away and comes back again. What is your foot doing or the lower limb to be causing that repetitive strain? Like I just showed you, if you have an overpronated foot, there's probably some devices that can help you on that end. Knowing what stretches and exercises to do as well. There's lots of stuff on Google, and not all of it is actually going to be productive towards healing your plantar fascia. You've done some work on some good exercises that really can help benefit it. You'll see lots of different exercises, towel grabs and things like that that aren't necessarily ever really proven or research-based. So it's always hard to know. Again, I would just get, you know, if it's coming back for you again or you've been dealing with it for a while, I would really just have someone take a look at your feet.
I think that the key here is there's different levels of the quality of service that you can have in this field. So it's like I've gone to physiotherapy and I'm not going to say that I had a bad experience. That don't have that as a negative impression on all physiotherapists. It's like having a bad wine and thinking all wine is bad. I mean, goodness no. Or beer, whatever your pleasure. But there's different qualities for any one of these treatments to be administered.
Something I'll add on that as well, if I can, is that one of the frustrating things with plantar fasciitis is just because one treatment works for one person definitely doesn't mean it works for the other person.
Yeah.
You know, there's lots of different treatment options out there. And, you know, in my profession, we would love to be able to say, hey, you know, you have plantar fasciitis, we're going to do X, Y, Z, and it's going to be gone.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, it doesn't really work that way. You know, there's somewhat trial and error in there. You know, we do our best job of trying to lead you in the right direction with that and suggesting what treatment options we think is going to be best. But there are so many out there, and everyone's feet are a little bit different to figure out which one works for you.
And so Haiti is written further here, if I go to Kintec, would I get that kind of expert advice? So yes, now it's Peter and my job to train and make sure our staff are up to speed on the latest, what is best practice in terms of managing plantar fasciitis. In fact, that was the topic of our recent training development seminar that we just hosted. Of course, bear in mind that you could see either Peter or myself in the clinic. We both spend a bit of time there. Obviously, it depends on where you're at. One of the things that we usually go through in a case where someone has not responded to previous treatments is I would want to know, well, what have you already tried? It's important here to not reinvent the wheel and just say, well, I'm going to throw the same type of orthotic or the same exercises. What have you tried? And let's build on that or modify that to make sure truly that we've exhausted all of the considered options. Of course, there are other more aggressive treatments that you can try in terms of PRP and prolotherapy and even some stem cell treatments if you want to spend $10,000 and go down to the United States. But we're Canadians and we're pragmatic and we tend to solve problems rather than just throw money at them. That's for a different segment.
I would suggest, yeah, just come in, like our fit experts on the floor put you through a base sort of gait analysis on the treadmill. You don't normally see a certified podorthist for just a walk-in appointment. That's a booked assessment. But I would always say, you know, if you're not sure, you have questions, our fit experts are very well in-house trained on answering those questions and at least leading you towards the first step, whether it is to see myself or Michael, or whether it is to see another podorthist, or just start with some different exercises, whatever that can be.
I've got another question on the iPad.
Hey, too.
So Nicole has written in, thank you for the questions, and I like the dynamic live aspect here. Thank you, Haiti. So she writes that she loves her flip-flops, but not sore feet. Are those shoes there good? So I presume that you're referring to the assortment of shoes we have in the studio. Peter, could you describe why these shoes may be relevant for an individual with heel pain?
Sure, and we'll start with the flip-flop, because I'm guessing she's talking about that, not the Hoka right now. You know, a lot of times you're going to hear flip-flops are bad for you, and a lot of them are. When you're looking at footwear and plantar fasciitis, especially, you know, why would this be good for you? I don't know how well it picks up on the camera, but this flip-flop is made by an off-the-shelf insole company. So it comes with a contoured medial arch.
Show them the contour, Peter.
Like this? Yeah. Like that? I can't look at that at the same time. I'm trying to make eye contact. So if, say again, we talked about overpronation a little bit, so let's look at the other foot type, which we call a pes cavus, or a more rigid, high-arched foot. And a lot of times, that means that there's a lot of impact force giving down onto the heel. So when you use a contoured flip-flop like this, we're looking for more even weight distribution through the foot. By get in contact in the medial arch, we take some of that increased load away from the heel and away from where that plantar fascia inserts. Another thing with this flip-flop, again, I'm not sure if this is going to show, but it has a touch of a front rocker to it. Not a huge one, but you can see what a front rocker is. It's a curve up through the front of that flip-flop. The plantar fascia tissue, as I said at the beginning, helps propel the foot forward and is used as you get through toe-off. So the more rocker there is on any shoe, the better sort of the roll-off is going to be and can decrease some of that load. And we can see a large front rocker here, and this is the Hoka. Not only is the curve bigger and stronger, so you get that easy roll off, you can see how stiff it is when I try to flex through this shoe. That will take a lot of the stress off of that plantar fascia, and the shoe really helps just that foot propel forward.
Good. Okay. Good. That product there.
Plantar fasciitis night splint, everyone's favorite treatment option, I would say. So this is what you wear when you sleep. It's very common that as you relax, and as you sleep, your foot, the toes actually point down. As that happens, it actually shortens the length of the plantar fascia. And of course, you know, with any sort of injury like this, it's rest that you need. So now you're finally off your feet, your plantar fascia is allowed to recover, and now we're recovering in a shortened state. You wake up in the morning, you take a step, and you get that morning pain. So what the night splint does is tries to hold your foot in more of a 90 degree angle. This allows that plantar fascia to heal in a longer state, and at the same time, we're probably going to put some stretch into your calf as well, which is also usually very tight when you have plantar fasciitis. Always come together. You know, it can be a little trying to get used to it. We suggest, you know, if this is a product you're going to use, when you first use it, everyone always wants to put it on really tight. I got this product, it's going to solve all my problems. But if you can only sleep for about an hour before this thing wakes you up, and then you take it off and throw it on the floor, it's not going to be doing much for you. So when you first put it on, you want to stretch it out a little bit and just loosely do up these straps here. And slowly, progressively, you can tighten that more and get a better stretch on your plantar fascia and your calf.
And also, if this looks daunting, we do have a different top-mounted
version of this. Yes, there's sort of three different versions. And again, the basis is always the same. We want to hold that foot as close to 90 degrees as we can. I like this one because your foot doesn't have a choice. Once it's in here, it's going to be stuck in that position. There is a dorsal night splint where the brace part goes on top of the foot here instead of under it like the boot. And there is a sock type as well. Maybe you've heard of the Strasbourg sock. All those things, they have the same goal behind them, and that's to hold that foot at 90 degrees.
Strasbourg sock is a little different, isn't it? Because it engages that wind lasso. So it does give you, maybe you can adjust it so that it's pulling on the toes. So you get more of a wind-up of the plantar fascia and more of a plantar fascia or a long flexor-specific stretch, which is great, but also leads to a different fit that not everybody appreciates. Is that a fair?
Yeah, you know, it's the one everyone gravitates to because who would rather wear a sock versus a brace, right? But unless you have a relatively well-defined calf belly, I always find that it's hard for the sock to actually stay up. The anchor point, which is usually just a strap and some Velcro, has to sit above something that is girthier, you know, below the strap. So unless there's a nice sort of defined calf belly for that to anchor to, it makes it pretty hard.
There's a question here about running, but I'm going to pause for a second and ask you, who do you think is one of the most common demographics or like causative factors? Or is it a workplace condition? I know for me that likely is. Yeah. If I ask somebody, if the 9 times out of 10 someone coming in to see me with foot pain, I'll ask, why do you have it? And they'll say, because I stand for a long period of time at work. Yeah. I even though it is a top 10 running injury, I don't see that much in runners as often as in some. Is that something that you see as well?
Yeah, I would agree. You definitely can have it as a runner, but you definitely don't need to be a runner to get it. You know, they see it a lot with either walking or standing specific jobs, a lot of, you know, steel-toed boots and concrete, you know, I'd say is one of the most common. So there's a lot of jobs out there. You got to wear steel-toed shoes and you're working on concrete all day, whether it's standing or walking. For some reason, that combination is probably the most that I see.
Okay. Let's go to some of the email questions that we have from people. So thank you for sending these in. The first question refers to one of the patients that has a disc problem in the lumbar spine from L5 to S1. And when it presses on a nerve that goes all the way down the leg, I guess there's some referred pain here. The question's asking, can this be related to plantar fasciitis? What's your thoughts on that?
Yeah, well, as I said at the beginning, it's sort of lower limb biomechanics is where my expertise lies. You know, I would probably push that one back to you a little bit if you have a bit more experience in how the nerve reaction down to the foot is going to affect it.
Probably it's it could be related to foot pain, but it would be a different type of pain. A lot of times, chronic soft tissue pain presents the way that you describe, Peter, with that sharp pain first thing in the morning. It has a certain pattern to it that will warm up through the day and then become bad at the end of the day after standing, whereas a more neurological-based pain, if it's a referred pain or something called radiculopathy, then it could be a different type, a different sensation. Instead of it being a sharp stabbing type of pain, it may feel tingly, more electrical in nature, and it might be caused by different things. So certain postures, such as slumping or sitting, might elicit pain in the foot, where there's a stretch or a compression on parts of the back. I think this is something that we don't tend to see a lot of this, but if there is a suspicion that we do have a neurological component, usually we would then refer them to a physiotherapist in that's in our referral group for that.
Yeah, that makes the most sense. You know, we would look at it from a biomechanical position on our end and see, is there anything leading to it? And if not, that's where we use those outside sources.
We have another question from Sharon. I have plantar's fasciitis. I love different names for plantar fasciitis. It's a tough one, right? The double I in there. It just, I guess it's a Latin.
I'm pretty sure I spelled it plantars for at least a year or two in my career. Maybe not the high point of it.
And I think, so Sharon writes a similar question that we went through before with Haiti. That's, it's like a railroad spike shoved into my heel rather than stepping on a tack. A railroad spike, I'm sure, would hurt more. She's done a variety of different things, including physio, shoes and socks, stretching, and chiro. I presume that she's asking what next. And I think we touched on that a little bit as far as just making sure to touch base with the fundamentals and that each one of those was delivered to a standard that you think was appropriate or intuitive. Did it make sense, the advice that your respective therapists were giving you? And go back and revisit areas that you think could be, you know, a little more work.
Yeah, Sharon, it sounds like it's a very, very common course with plantar fasciitis. Like, rarely when I see someone am I their first step. You know, it's I've tried a Dr. Scholl's insole. I've tried a different stretch, some different shoes, some different icing, and it's always seems it's going to be a combination of things when you get to the end of it. Trying to delve into what that root cause is, you know, again, is it tightness? Okay, well then stretching exercises are really going to be a good base for your treatment. It might not be all of it, but it's definitely an important set in there. You know, am I in steel-toed shoes all day? Is that going to lead with the sort of decreased shock absorption that you might find in a shoe like that? Okay, well then how do we increase shock absorption for your foot? Is that a custom orthotic? Is that a prefab insole that matches your foot properly? So, you know, I think it's always good to get an overall assessment when you have plantar fasciitis. If you go somewhere and all they do is they kind of look at just muscle tightness in you and they don't ask about what your daily life is like, well, then we might not find that root cause. So, you know, you got to spend some time with someone to answer a bunch of questions, things that you may not even think is relevant to the problem, but it helps us get the best overall picture for you and try to figure out how to solve it.
Right. Well, I think that brings us to an end here, unless there are any other... Oh, we got a new question right on the line. Thank you, Christy. She writes, I missed what sandals brand are best for doing lots of summer walking for someone with this condition.
Brand is always a hard one.
Good question.
Thanks, Christy.
Great question. Seasonally appropriate.
Yeah, it's there's different features, and again, it's going to be different foot types that are going to benefit for them. One that would quickly come to mind is we carry a sandal made by a brand. It's Cambrian. And the big benefit for them is out of a sandal, they have a really wicked rocker. You know, they have that strong curve on it. And if, again, we're trying to decrease load to that tissue, that sandal is going to help do that by aiding in that propulsion factor. You know, there's sandals with the pre-molded arch supports, sole, super feet, Montrail, lots of different ones out there. And again, it's not one size fits all. Someone to look at your feet and try to match your arch height. And you know, there's lots of research when it comes to shoes and sandals and, you know, which one's best, and I think some of the stuff that's come out lately really speaks to how do you feel in it. Do you feel comfortable in that shoe? And that might be the best one for you. You know, it's there's lots of things we've always looked at, whether it's over pronation, under pronation, stability shoes, but it's patient comfort that really comes down to the key. What is helping you reduce your pain?
So. If it's not comfortable, you're not going to use it. No. So take advantage of that. Also, it's also important to mention that we can also do custom sandals.
Can.
I had an order for one of those yesterday.
Yes.
Maybe you want to speak a bit to what a custom sandal?
Sure.
If you find, maybe just to preface this a little, so if you try some of the sandals and you feel that you need a little bit more more arch support and a bit more control, more than the sandals that you're getting, and you feel that you've had success with custom orthotics in the past, then a custom sandal may be just what you're looking for.
Yeah. I kind of answered what I was going to say.
What is it?
So with custom orthotics and with custom sandals, we do a 3D volumetric mold of your foot. There's been lots of different ways over the years, but we use more of a sort of 3D imager right now, you know, but it can be done with a plaster cast or a foam box cast, and from that we would mold the actual sandal. We can do things like custom Birkenstocks, which is you use the Birkenstock as sort of the original layout, and then we build this positive cast of your foot and use that to relate the two together, whether we need to add arch contact, take away arch contact, add heel cushioning, and then throw new top covers on top of that. So again, it comes down to what your foot needs, but the custom option is pretty cool. I had tons of patients over the years, and you know, you get them in, they're a nice supportive shoe, they're a nice supportive orthotic, they're feeling great. Well, it's, you know, 25 degrees outside, I don't want to be wearing a black walking shoe right now, how do I do it? And that custom sandal is a good option.
Hades written back, we haven't talked much about shockwave therapy.
We have not.
Is that anything you've had experience with?
Well, again, it's not in my realm of treatments. I definitely have had patients that have used it, and some swear by it and say it definitely helped with their pain. But I've also had patients that have done lots of sessions with and have not got the results. But that's no different than a lot of other treatment options out there. It's, again, some things work for some people. Again, I would look at who are you getting this treatment from? You know, is it from a physiotherapist or a chiropractor, someone with you know, some knowledge in the plantar fascia world and how it works. But it's definitely a common treatment option out there now. I don't know if you want to speak on it a bit more.
Yeah, I think it's changed a little bit from, because it was introduced to me in the early 2000s, and it was a slightly different form because it was a bit more of a focused shockwave therapy. So it was a sort of extracorporeal focused beam. And I think now it's a bit more, I think it's a radial shockwave treatment that's commonplace now. A lot of more progressive physio clinics and some chiro clinics will have it. And the mechanisms for it are, at least for the original one, were a bit nebulous. So it was understood that this was in some way disturbing the tissue, so it was encouraging an inflammatory response that would then, which is one of the steps in wound healing, but it also might interfere with pain. I think that was another mechanism at work, so it would interfere with the pain system so that it would effectively numb your heel. I think the radial side is similar, but a bit more directed on the tissue perturbation side. So people can often be in quite a bit of discomfort after they've tried it, but then their longer term success seems to be good, provided it's directed to the right type of person. Probably important to speak on this is that you shouldn't use shockwave therapy for an inflammatory condition, because then you might be just making it worse. And so most of the time, if people have had plantar fasciitis for a period of 6 weeks or longer, it's unlikely to be largely inflammatory, but more a structural breakdown. And as Peter was saying, that sort of nervous system sensitivity to both pressure and touch. And so this is where shockwave therapy helps to kickstart that healing. But it used in conjunction with physio is, I've heard it's a good next step for people. It doesn't hurt though. Oh, okay. Hayden says she didn't find it hurts. I've had a couple patients that have had it done on their feet and it's hurt quite a bit. I think maybe it depends on
who you see it and how they use it, right?
Another question from Christy. What do we think about acupuncture?
Yeah, there's a local guy where I work out of a lot of times, which is Maple Ridge, that has had really good success with some patients in using acupuncture with plantar fasciitis. I think a lot of times we're trying to loosen up some of that muscle tension with the needling, whether it's through a physiotherapist or different professions. I do some research behind the person before you head in there, and again, it's go through your basics, do your stretching, do your icing, do your exercises, the things you can do by yourself. Okay, they're not working, you know, where do we go from there? You know, you have someone take a look at your foot mechanics, have someone take a look at and the tightness, you know, again, through the calf, through the plantar fascia. I think getting your plantar fascia needled is pretty painful as well. I've heard from some people, and usually it's more up through the calf and the Achilles complex that's going to happen, but it is a definite treatment option for plantar fasciitis.
And again, it's something to consider if these other conservative methods don't work. Be clear, though, whether you're getting IMS, so this intramuscular stimulation treatment for relaxing muscles. I guess more contemporary acupuncture that's more related, that's closer to the area for pain relief, or traditional Chinese medicine acupuncture
that's
going to put a needle on the top of your head for pain in your foot based on energy lines. And so they're very different mechanisms that involve needles. Some of them are called acupuncture. There's other treatments for it, other names for it. So it's worth pursuing, and the main thing is that you feel confident in the person doing it. I think that's really what it comes down to. So, and with that, we're going to have to wrap this session up. So certainly thank you, Peter, for joining us
in the
studio today. Really like to thank our producer, Montana, for putting the show on today, and for our wonderful guests for giving us some questions and making this a lively Facebook Live. So we'll see you next time.
Thanks.